I saw this article in the online journal Popular Mechanics the other day, and I thought, oh, that looks interesting. And then I thought, hang on a minute, capacitors and batteries are two completely different animals, aren't they? I mean, everything I've learnt about capacitors in the past tells me we can never use them to replace batteries, they just don't have enough useful energy density. So I downloaded the actual research paper to see if I could summarise its findings so you don't have to. And oh my goodness, this one's a doozy. It's got all the clever scientific words. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. I like capacitors as a rule. In fact, I'd probably struggle to live without them, and arguably so would you. And that's because they're pretty much essential to the way just about every conceivable modern gadget works. In fact, other than resistors, there are apparently more capacitors in a typical electronic circuit than any other passive component, by which I mean a component that doesn't require an external power source and doesn't amplify electrical signals. What I really like about them is the elegant simplicity of their design. Essentially, a typical capacitor is just two strips of metal stuck to either side of a bit of insulating material that the science pods call a dielectric. Some sort of ceramic material usually does that job quite nicely. In something like a phone or a laptop, capacitors can provide short bursts of high power for occasional tasks like the flash on your phone camera, but they can also take the edge off that initial surge of electrons that you get when you flick the on switch, because they absorb some of that tsunami to fill themselves up with charge. And that results in a soft start that protects your very expensive equipment. And it performs the same very useful task when the power's switched off as well. So all those little lights on various electronic gizmos that don't go out instantly but sort of fade out gradually, well, what you're essentially watching there is the equalization of a capacitor. The simplicity of the structure in capacitors means they last forever, or at least millions of cycles anyway, which is of course a feature that developers would dearly love to see in batteries as well. There are lots of other useful applications for capacitors that would take too long to go through here, but one application that is probably worth mentioning is in the regenerative braking systems of modern electric vehicles. You're no doubt familiar with regen braking by now. If you want to slow an EV down, instead of pressing the brake pedal, you can scrub off the vehicle's momentum by using that kinetic energy to make the electric motor work like a generator to put some charge back into your batteries. But rather than allowing those electrons to flood into the battery pack all at once, potentially causing a bit of unwanted extra degradation, capacitors absorb that high power and deliver it back into the batteries more gradually. The downside with capacitors is that although they have high power density, they have very low energy density, typically in the range of microjoules or millijoules per cubic centimetre. Even modern supercapacitors, which are an attempt at a sort of hybrid structure between a capacitor and a battery, only generally reach a few watt hours per kilogram, compared to, say, a lithium ion battery that can provide upwards of 250 watt hours per kilogram. And that's frustrating for developers, because if you could combine the almost instant charging capability of a capacitor with the high energy density of a battery, you'd have a laptop that charged up in seconds and a car that went from 0 to 100% charge in about the same time it takes to fill up an equivalent fossil fuel powered vehicle. The performance of a typical capacitor tends to be limited by the ability of the dielectric material between the two metal plates to hold an electric charge. It's what the science pods call low polarization. There are some exotic sounding ferroelectric materials like hafnium dioxide, zirconium dioxide, and barium titanate that offer high polarization, but they also have what's known as high remnant polarization, which means they hold onto some charge when they should be releasing it, making them less efficient for energy storage. To solve that annoying wrinkle, the science pods have been developing what they call relaxor ferroelectric materials that have tiny little defects engineered into them to produce so-called nanodomains that enable high energy storage with low remnant polarization. Trouble is, the process of creating those nanodomains often reduces the material's overall quality and ability to achieve maximum polarization. Plus, some methods result in a phenomenon known as polarization saturation at low electric fields, which also limits the amount of energy the capacitor can store. And that's where the researchers at Washington University reckon they've made a major leap forward. They tell us that their approach controls the relaxation time using two-dimensional materials while minimizing energy loss by using 2D, 3D, 2D heterostructures and preserving the crystallinity of ferroelectric 3D materials. And good for them. What does that mean though? Well, in terms that I can get my head around, it means they've come up with a method to improve energy storage in capacitors by using super thin, two-dimensional materials created using a specially developed technique that splits them into single layers. Those 2D layers are then combined with a single crystal layer of barium titanate, which is one of those ferroelectric materials I mentioned earlier that's very good at holding an electric charge. Unlike other methods that degrade the quality of ferroelectric materials, sandwiching the barium titanate between the 2D outer layers preserves its single crystal nature without altering its structure. Interactions between the layers at the point where they meet help control the relaxation time of polarization, which as we saw earlier is the time it takes for material to return to its normal state after being charged. And that helps maintain a high charge capacity while reducing unwanted residual charges. So that's the method, or at least it's an extremely limited attempt by yours truly to summarize the incredibly complicated workings set out in the paper. But what about the results? Well, according to the Washington University team, their lab tests produced a capacitor with an energy density of 191.7 joules per cubic centimeter with an efficiency of over 90%. In other words, they've got something that can store a large amount of energy, lose far less energy, and maintain high performance with minimal degradation. Sounds great, right? So when can we expect to see these things powering all our electric vehicles then? Yeah, it's never quite that simple, is it? According to people far smarter than me, the density of barium titanate is about 6,000 kilograms per cubic meter, and that 191.7 joules per cubic centimeter that I just mentioned equates to 53,250 watt hours per cubic meter. So now we've got units that are the same, which means we can divide that number by the density of barium titanate to give us 8.875 watt hours per kilogram. That's not going to be challenging the supremacy of a 250 watt hour per kilogram lithium ion battery anytime soon, is it? But that's not really the point here, to be honest. The goal is not to replace batteries, but to produce something that can enhance their performance and increase their longevity. What the Washington University bods have managed to do is retain the extremely simple structure of a capacitor while increasing its ability to capture, retain, and release electric charge by a factor of 19x. That potentially means much faster charging times and a significant reduction in the amount of stress and strain on the batteries of electronic devices and electric vehicles. It also means significantly improved flexibility in utility-scale energy storage systems. The research team are now putting their heterostructure capacitor through its paces in extended testing to ensure it can keep working its magic without losing storage capacity over repeated cycles. But if the results of that come out clean, then we could be looking at one of those transformational game changers that YouTubers like me are always banging on about. And that'd be nice, wouldn't it? So what do you think? Could this be one of those breakthroughs that results in a technological step change? Do you work in the industry and have additional insights that you can share with us all? Or do you just have some observations and feedback that you want to add? Whatever it is, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comments section below here. And I'll be interested to see what you say. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our fantastic Patreon supporters who help keep this channel completely independent and keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. And I must just give a quick shout out to some fine folks who joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are John Paterson, Tom Heung, William Graham, Phil Beecham, Richard MacDonald Woods, Daniel Orme, Kenneth Kerr, Simon B, Farm Thompson, Tim Camilleri, Jerry Lindrup, Alf Chammings, Joseph Mersnick, and Robert B. Alf. If you find these videos useful and informative and you feel like you could support the channel for a dollar a month or more, then why not pop over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to have a look at the exclusive benefits you can enjoy there. And of course you can hugely support us right here on YouTube by hitting the like and subscribe buttons and clicking on all notifications so you don't miss out on new videos. It won't cost you a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.